everyone. My name is Heather. It is so great to be back here with you this morning. I always tell everybody this is my favorite campus of Grace Church. But don't tell anyone at the Cape campus that I said that. Yeah, well, sorry about that. Well, I don't know if you know, but I have three kids, one of them Roddy, who is 6'4" and a lot of pounds. He played football, and he's just a big guy. Well, when he was a little guy, he liked to eat just as much as he does now. Well, I will never forget the first time that Roddy experienced communion as a child in big church. So we were sitting in our chairs, and after waiting our turn and coming up the aisle and receiving the bread and the juice and then taking a moment to pray at the altar, we returned back to our seats in the chairs, and then Roddy leaned over, he tapped me on the shoulder, and he said, "Mommy, can we go again? I'm still very hungry." And you know what I say to that? Amen, Roddy. Amen, right? Aren't we all? Well, today is World Communion Sunday, which is really cool because it unites congregations of many Christian denominations all over the globe who gather in churches, big and small, on farms and in cities, in fancy historic cathedrals, and even under tents to receive the bread and the cup of Holy Communion. But you know, it's not only on this day that we celebrate the Lord's Supper. You see, the sacrament of communion is celebrated by Christ followers at various times and in various places and in different ways throughout the year as well. I've seen the body and the blood of Christ received in worship services, at weddings, in hospital rooms, in homeless camps, in people's living rooms, at meetings, on mission fields, and even on a bus once. I've taken communion that is cut neatly, where the bread is cut neatly into little cubes, when it's formed into wafers. I've used potato chips. Yep. I've torn it directly from the loaf. I've dipped the bread into grape juice and into wine. I've received it served in beautiful ceramic chalices like this one. I've also received it in a bright red solo cup. Amen? Right. Well, I've sipped it from tiny plastic cups too. And even from a large common cup, which hundreds of other people also sipped from the same cup. Well, I know that some groups celebrate communion weekly, some monthly, and some seldom at all. But you know, no matter where or when or how communion is shared, it can be an unusually powerful experience if we really, really understand what it's all about. So I thought maybe today it would be a good idea to spend some time just going back to the basics and figuring out what the big deal about communion really is and focusing on why and how, as Christ followers, we should celebrate. Sound good? So there are three ways for us to consider this celebration. Now the first is to consider the celebration as it's most commonly called, communion. Now, the word communion actually just means sharing. And communion carries with it the idea that when we gather around the bread and the juice, we commune not just with God, but with each other as well. See, there's something a little mystical about taking a piece of bread and a mouthful of juice in memory of Jesus' death. It unites us as the family of God, and it focuses our mission on Jesus' death, right? It focuses our mission that God gave us to go and to love other people just the way God called us to do. You know, this is especially meaningful for us today. Think about it. Knowing that right now we are in community with hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of other believers around the world who are doing this today. That's pretty cool. A second way to consider this celebration is Eucharist. Eucharist is a word that means thanksgiving. When we gather together around the table of God and share the bread and the juice, we're giving thanks to God for his big sacrifice. When Jesus died on the cross, he took upon himself our sinfulness. Any sinners in the room? Yeah. Yeah, so the sacrifice that Jesus made for you and for me, think, it's just so lavish. It's so extreme. It's matchless, right? And our only appropriate response can be humble, yet overwhelming gratitude. A third way to consider this celebration is what we sometimes call the Lord's Supper. You know, the Bible tells us that as Jesus gathered on the night before he was killed with his 12 closest friends to celebrate the Hebrew festival called Passover with a wonderful meal. Well, Passover is the Jewish celebration of God's delivering the Israelites from bondage in Israel. But Jesus changed that long-standing tradition, and instead, he made it his meal. When he took bread and he said, "This is my body," and he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood." But why? Why do Christ followers celebrate communion? Well, let's today focus on two biblical reasons for celebrating this sacrament. First, Jesus initiated it. Matthew 26, verse 26, gives us the words that Jesus spoke at the first communion. Let's read it together. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Well, have you ever heard the phrase, "Don't tell me, show me," or maybe "actions speak louder than words," right? You're familiar with that? Well, God knows this principle too. He knows that we don't just need the words of the Bible to say, "I love you." We also need some kind of tangible, concrete demonstrations. So God showed people he could not only talk the talk, but he could walk the walk. And the most powerful demonstration of God's love was when he came to earth as a baby, who grew up to be a man, who taught and healed, and then ultimately gave his life on a cross. You know, symbols are really powerful, and they can bring about in us deep emotions. Think about it. Wedding rings, right? They symbolize our love and our commitment to our husbands and our wives before God. What about the American flag? It symbolizes freedom and pride and in the country that we call home. And then there's the cross, right? Is there one? The cross. What does it symbolize? Christianity, Jesus. And then there are those symbols that can bring up some negative things, right? Maybe a Nazi swastika, or a KKK, or a violent gang symbol. All symbols can be pretty powerful, can't they? Well, Jesus understood this reality. And so before he left for the garden on the night he was arrested, he told his followers this: "Whenever you gather together around this meal, remember my love for you." Jesus gave us this concrete, tangible symbol of his love and his grace in the form of communion. So have you ever thought of communion that way, as a symbol to remind you of Jesus and what he's done for you? Jesus took the bread, he gave it new meaning, and he made it a symbol. When he said, "This is my body," the bread symbolizes his body that's about to be broken. It symbolizes his life that is about to be taken. Jesus is pointing to the crucifixion and to his death. Jesus would be pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our sins. By his wounds, we are healed. Amen. Well, so for the first century Jew, blood was even more important. A person's very life, their essence, and their being was in the blood. In the Jewish faith, the forgiveness of sins required the slaughtering of animals at an altar. See, because in Jewish eyes, all blood was sacred to God. That's why at Passover, the symbolic sacrifice was a lamb, reminding the Jews about the night in Egypt when the angel of death passed over the doorposts marked with blood. So to drink the cup meant to share in the blessing of what that blood did. The blood was the symbol of the new covenant, a new agreement before God and humankind. See, God would forever look at those who accepted Jesus' sacrifice as cleansed by the blood. Do you think of that when you have communion? I'm being cleansed by this, right? So the second reason we celebrate communion is that the first church implemented it. See, following Jesus' lead, the first church, led by 11 of the 12 who were in the upper room at that first communion, regularly practiced what Jesus taught. Acts 2:42 tells us they joined with the other believers and devoted themselves, sharing in the Lord's Supper. Acts 20, verse 7 says, on the first day of the week, we gathered to observe the Lord's Supper. See, communing with God and one another was a regular practice of the first Christ followers. And I love to think how in the 20 centuries since then, Christ followers have continued to share together in God's love and mercy through bread and juice. Imagine how many times communion has been given and received on this planet since that very first time. It's really unimaginable, isn't it? How many times do you think you've done it? It's a symbolic tradition that seems endless. Well, here's the problem with endless traditions. Sometimes they lose their meaning, and we don't focus on what it's really all about. I think sometimes this happens with communion too. We get comfortable with communion. It's just something we do on the first Sunday of every month, right? And we go through the motions and we forget about the emotions connected to it. We know why communion is observed, but every now and then, as Christ followers, it's a good idea to take a step back and to also remember how. How should I receive communion? Well, if Jesus initiated it and the first church implemented it, how do I approach this gift of love and mercy? Well, as I studied the Bible this week, two insights came to me. First, I think we should receive it joyfully. Listen to how Acts 2:46 describes the nature of the gathering of those first Christ followers. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great what? Joy and generosity. Great joy. I love that God wants the nature of our gatherings together as Christ followers to be joyful. I was thinking about this as Rochelle, we started worship and she invited you to go and greet one another. Man, I would love to see that at the Cape campus at the 8:30 service. You know, we do that same thing. We invite people to greet one another, and they do this. Good morning. Good morning. And then they begin singing. But it's like a party in here. I love it. God loves it too. That's what he intends the gathering of believers to look like. Jesus gave his life on the cross not so that we could sit and sulk in guilt, but so that we could celebrate in thanksgiving, right? Yeah. So as Christians, we use the phrase, celebrate the Lord's Supper. And you know what? The last time I looked up celebrate in the dictionary, it meant something happy. So when we celebrate things in this country, a lot of times it involves balloons, sometimes gifts, sometimes confetti, bright decorations, music, dancing, and almost always what? You got it. Food, right? When we celebrate Independence Day, when we celebrate New Year's, there are what? Fireworks. We should have fireworks for communion, shouldn't we? Well, when we celebrate sports victories, my goodness, the Gators played yesterday. And there are loud, boisterous cheers and hugging and high fives. And none of that is bad. But I think those of us who know Jesus and his love ought to be at least as joyful about that as we are about some of these other celebrations. Would you agree? Yeah. So think about the tradition of Thanksgiving. At our house, we get up early, right? The kids all want to watch the parade, so the TV goes on. But as if that's not enough noise, then we also start playing Christmas carols, right? So the kids are watching the parade on the TV, the Christmas carols are playing, Rod's in the kitchen cooking from like 6 a.m. It's ridiculous. The house is filled with these wonderful smells. He's barking. Well, the dogs do that, but you know, he's making all kinds of noise about the cooking. It doesn't take long before the kids start wrestling, right? When it warms up enough, then they're wrestling in the pool. And then lots of people start arriving. The adults are laughing. Thanks are given. Food is eaten. It is a celebration. And this spirit of joy, I think, should be the spirit of communion too. We should consider communion as the great Thanksgiving, right? Yeah. Well, second, when it comes to communion, I think we should also receive it thoughtfully. You know, the Bible gives us some very clear direction about not coming to communion haphazardly. So haphazardly and joyfully are two different things. Joyful and thoughtful go together. Haphazard and thoughtful, not so much, right? So this instruction is given to those who have given their lives to Jesus. It's for Christians. In 1 Corinthians 11, verses 27 and 28, Paul writes this: "Anyone who eats the bread or drinks the cup of the master irreverently is like part of the crowd that jeered and spit on him at his death." Is that the kind of remembrance you want to be a part of? Examine your motives, test your heart, come to this meal in holy awe. See, Paul is writing to the church in Corinth that had turned church gatherings just into gluttonous feasts. There was no thanksgiving. He warns them to carefully examine their hearts when they come to communion. Does this mean that you have to be perfect before you come to communion? Nope, because none of us would be there, would we? That's like trying to get clean before you get in the shower, right? Well, there are two realities going on at the same time when you receive communion. First, you're a sinner. I'm a sinner. God knows it. You know it. I know it. You're not worthy of God's love. I'm not worthy of God's love. But thankfully, he gives that love so freely. Second, once you become a Christ follower, you have a responsibility to live like a Christ follower. So don't mock God by saying one thing but living another way. Paul warns us to each look at our hearts, come as grateful sinners to God's feast of love and mercy. See, in a few minutes, we're going to celebrate communion together, and the hope of God is that we would celebrate with a balance of both joy and thoughtfulness. You know, a few weeks ago at Eat, Pray, Love Dinner Church in Suncoast, I witnessed the most beautiful encounter with Jesus while serving communion. After we had finished our supper and we'd had a discussion about Jesus, the bread and the juice were offered to everyone in the room. And you know, because many of our friends at dinner church, they don't really have any church background, the communion environment at Eat, Pray, Love is a little bit different than what we normally would experience here in a sanctuary. Let's just say it's not quiet. While everyone is invited to share the bread and the juice, many choose to just leave instead, and that's okay. Well, as I was standing in the front of the room and I was holding the basket of bread, a young man and his friends got up to walk out the exit door. Well, as they walked past the bread and the juice, this one young man stared at me, and then he kind of glanced at the elements as he walked toward the exit. But then suddenly, he turned around and he came back to where I was standing and said the most interesting thing. He said, "I think I'd like to get in on that bread party after all." So I smiled and I winked at him and I said, "Awesome." And as I offered the bread, I read his name off the tag on his shirt and I said, "Tommy, this is the body of Christ that's been broken for you." And he smiled as he dipped the bread in the cup and ate it and just kind of stood there for a minute, and then he started to leave. He turned back around once again, and he came back and reached out and gave me this big old hug. And he said, "Thank you. I really liked that." You know, that was a powerful moment for me, because from the joy on Tommy's face and the gratitude in his voice, it was obvious to me that Jesus had met Tommy somehow at that communion table. You know, Jesus wants to meet you at this communion table every single time. Every time. He wants you to know that the bread is his body. On his body, he took all of the wrongs you have done and the wrongs that have been done to you. So as you eat the bread, remember that Jesus' body was broken for you. He died on a cross for you. Take it and eat it and let Jesus take upon his body this morning all of your affliction. He was broken for your sin, for your failures, for your misery. Your sins are forgiven. My sins are forgiven. That's big. That should bring us joy. And then as you take the cup, remember that you've been redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. Remember that the blood represents the very life of Jesus, now living in you. Do you struggle with a certain sin? Maybe you have a temper that you're having a hard time controlling. Are there insecurities that are dogging you day and night? Remember, there is power in that blood to set you free. And these are not things to take lightly, but to consider thoughtfully and to celebrate joyfully. You know, we all can laugh at the story of little Roddy leaving the communion table hungry for more. But really, isn't that a really appropriate response? Shouldn't we leave that table feeling so loved and so empowered that we want more? More of God's love and more of God's mercy and grace. More of the joy and the freedom that we experience in knowing his Son. More of the power we can receive from the Holy Spirit. Friends, this morning I'm excited to join the Lord Jesus at this table with all of you. Let's go ahead and join him thoughtfully and joyfully as we celebrate that no sin can separate us from God's love. Amen? Amen. No failure is final. Amen? Amen? And our life is eternal. Amen? Amen? All right, let's celebrate. Now I'd like to invite Dan and Sarah to come up and help us along with the band. And if you all will follow along on the screen, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Your turn. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. And so on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Everyone, holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All are invited to come now. The table is open to everyone. Come down the center aisle to receive the bread and dip it into the juice. The altar is open for prayer as well.